You are listening to Ideas and Leaders Podcast. I'm Elena Paventa, Executive Communication Coach and TEDx Organizer. With each episode, I'll share with you communication tips and ideas from top business leaders to help you excel in your career. Hi, everyone. Welcome to the next episode of Ideas and Leaders Podcast. Today, I am connecting with Australia and I have a great guest, Anne-Marie Cross. She's a personal branding and podcast strategist and a business coach. And as I love podcasting, as our listeners know, it is so exciting to speak about profitable podcasting for service-based businesses today. Hi, Anne-Marie.
How are you, Elena? It's a pleasure to be here today.
It is so great to have you here. So can you tell us a little bit more about your background? How did you start with podcasting?
Oh, great question. That takes me right back to 2008. And I was working in the career industry as a career practitioner. So resume writing, interview coaching, helping people get noticed, get hired, get paid what they're worth for their dream job. And back in 2008, for those who can recall, that was when the global financial crisis hit. And many people around the world found themselves unemployed. Things were really tough. And a colleague and I, we had separate businesses. He was also in the career industry. We were very disillusioned by the doom and gloom of mainstream media. Across every single platform, they were talking about job losses and the crisis and so forth. And we said, we really need to be the voice of hope and inspiration, because whilst we knew it was more difficult and job seekers had to change their approach to job search, we knew that it wasn't impossible. But if people continued to listen to the doom and gloom, it was going to impact them. So we started Career Success Radio. We had no idea what we were doing, but the vision and the drive to be able to support people around the world really pulled us through. And we did that show for 2 years. And as they say, I've never looked back. To continue to podcast, love the medium, such as yourself. It's such a great way to connect with people from all over the world. And whilst you're sharing their message, or if you're doing a solo show, your own message, you can get to connect and empower and inspire people all over the world. So it's quite an amazing technology.
Yeah, I love podcasting myself. I would say that I'm a newbie in the industry, because Ideas and Leaders is about a year old. So I started the podcast last year. And I know that many people, they are planning to start their podcasts right now, because people keep asking me, how did you do it? How did you start? What is needed? So what, in your opinion, what is the most important question that we need to ask ourselves when we start a podcast, so that it can be profitable for our business in the future?
Yeah, great, great question. And this is the things that I share today are very much the things that I learned through trial and error. And I wish someone back then had have given me a handbook and said to me, Anne-Marie, these are the things that you need to do. These are the things that you need to avoid. But back then, of course, the audience, their listeners were far less and there were no real mentors. So everything that I share today, I've gone and struggled through trial and error. But the first thing that I would say in a business, and this is a business 101, is to really start with the end in mind. And what do I mean by that? There's a number of different factors. Often I'll speak to people who have heard about the benefits of podcasting. And one of the reasons that they are thinking that a podcast would help them in their business is that their message is not really cutting through the noise. So we know that over the last couple of years, so many more businesses have come to the online space because they're no longer able to work face-to-face. A lot of corporate events and so forth, and even conferences have been closed down, slowly starting to open up. But I think people have really realized we need to have an online presence. And so often I'll say to people, well, if your message is not cutting through the noise already, if you've got a number of ideal clients, maybe you're networking online now and you're sharing your introduction, if no one is really getting in contact with you and saying, I think we need to talk, then focus on your message first. The reason being is that a podcast helps you amplify your message. But if your message is not already working, it's only going to amplify a message that's not working to many more people. And you want to make sure that your message, even on your podcast, is very niched and is going to really connect, engage, and provide real value to your ideal client. Because ultimately, the community that you continue to build, the listenership, the audience, you want them to be your ideal client, perhaps alliance partners, very much focused on leveraging the relationships that you build. So that's the first thing that I would think about is your message. And most often the first question I'm asked is, what microphone should I get? And that's where I say to people, well, message before microphone, because you cannot edit and mix compelling content that nurtures your ideal client along the buyer's journey from a message that's not really cutting through the noise or from fluff and banter. And what I mean by that respectfully is that sometimes we compare a podcast to mainstream radio, where they're might be a chat show and people getting there and we just kind of the conversation rolls. Now, that's nothing wrong with that per se, but if your ideal client is someone who's pushed for time, they're adult learners and they're wanting to come to listen to the podcast to grab a piece of content and information that they're struggling with, if you take too long to get to the topic and you're just not compelling and creating this unique listener experience, which is compelling, then unfortunately you may have just lost the opportunity to have someone go, I like the way that host interacted with the guest, or I like the way that person shared content. I'm going to listen to another podcast. I think I might listen to another one. And then before long, someone has subscribed because they love your energy, they love your charisma, they love the style that you bring to your podcast. And often when people don't do that intentionally, that's why I've called my programs Podcasting with Purpose. There's intention. You know who your ideal client is. All of these things can be integrated with what you're doing with a podcast. And often when people don't think about what's the end in mind, my ideal client, what's the purpose for my podcast, what's the call to action, how do I get them off the podcast, onto my list or in my community where I can continue to develop, know, like, and trust, these are all things that often then fall into that, look, I hope that people will listen and then come and hire me. And that was kind of the strategy that we hope, which really isn't a strategy, is it? For the first 2 years when I did my co-hosted podcast, we hope that people would listen and then come and want to find out more. But it never happened. So that's probably a really good place to start.
Yeah, I really love it that you say that microphone is not so important in the beginning. You need to think about your message. And this is what I'm always asked when people contact me and ask me about my podcast. They say, oh, how did you start? How do you edit? What kind of microphone do you have? But so they want to start something, but they still don't know what, but they already trying to find out about all those technical details. So we need to think, why do we need this podcast for our business? What is the business goal? Or if it is not for your business, maybe for it is your hobby, or it is you for, you know, academic purposes, you need to know, what is the goal? Who is your ideal listener? Who will listen to your podcast? And without this, it is really hard to start. And I can see that many people, they start podcasts and they just quit after some time. There are a couple of episodes and they just disappear. So there are so many distractions out there. What are the most common distractions, in your opinion, for people to quit podcasting?
Yeah, well, some of the things that I have seen is that people are excited about this new piece of technology or a platform that they can share their content. And then they start podcasting, they realize, you know what, there's actually quite a lot of work involved. And I have often heard, and I don't know if you've experienced this, I've experienced this sometimes myself, is that with a podcast, you can't see your audience. So you don't have the nodding heads and the laughter, you know, the engagement, yeah, and that you would if you were on stage, or even if you had a, you know, a group of people that you could see, you know, on Zoom and so forth, if you were presenting online. And so sometimes it can feel like you are speaking and sharing into an empty room. There's no real feedback, when actually there is. I think, and this is, I've heard this across other platforms too, not just podcasting, that people are reading your posts on social media, they are watching your videos, all of those things, but they're not necessarily getting in contact with you and saying, hey, Elena, I love that episode, thank you so much for sharing. That's only a small portion of the many people who listen. It's a bit like an iceberg, isn't it? The top, only a small portion of the top shows, but a lot of the bottom never really does. And I think that's such a great reminder. And so what happens then is, because there's no feedback, and they may not necessarily have set the podcast up the right way to be very much integrated in what they're doing, because you can publish a podcast episode, but if you're not really leveraging it and you haven't integrated it across in your business, and how else are you marketing, and can you, you know, make sure that some of the other, what I call brand communications, can you integrate that so that it's in part of your newsletter, part of your social media, in your bio, all of those things, to continue building the momentum, which we know is so important. People then start to, maybe they go a 4-week publication schedule, then it goes to once every 3 weeks, now it's once every 2 weeks, and then it's a, oh, when I get around to it, and then before you know it, they're not publishing very frequently at all, infrequently actually. And then there's a term, I believe, that people call that a podcast fade, and then people kind of just don't do that again, or they pick up and they go really, you know, batch a lot of these recordings. And that's what I heard happens too. They record all of these episodes, and then it just sits there on their computer, not being edited and not getting out there. And so that's probably one of the most common reasons, is because people run out of steam. Now, again, it depends on the strategy. I mean, I've got a podcast that I host for one of my alliance partners, and they are part of an Australian-wide networking and business development for business leaders, both, you know, in corporate, and this is women leaders, both in corporate and in running their own business. And so we have decided that the strategy is very much interviewing all of the premium members. So we want to feature the members, showcase their expertise. A lot of them are already trusted authorities, or they're just at the process of finalizing a lot of their content. And so we feature those particular premium members as guests. Now, that podcast was just listed as the number one Australian women's podcast here in Australia. Now, we publish when a new member comes on board. So we don't really have a frequency. We may try and do once every couple of weeks, but sometimes it's one a month. And so, you know, again, our strategy is to be very high quality, really speaking into the areas that we know women leaders across both corporate and business are struggling with. So obviously the audience is really, you know, valuing that, and not necessarily being, you know, well, I want to have something every week kind of thing. But that's a deliberate strategy that we've had with that podcast. So again, what's the overall goal? What's the purpose of starting that podcast? How can you best leverage it? And how can you consistently do what it is that you set the intention to do? Now, for us, it's not frequency, but rather quality.
Yes, yes. And I think that it is very important to work with a coach, as in everything in life, to work with someone who actually knows how podcasting works. Because I was working with a coach in the beginning, like yourself, with a podcast strategist, who said that consistency is the most important thing. You need to decide whether you will post once a week, or once a month, or twice a month, and just stick to it and just do it. I decided to make episodes once a week, and I think that it was the best decision, because it was the only decision that I did. And now I just I'm doing everything to keep those episodes going, and it is, so I'm not thinking about it anymore. And I don't have this effect that you mentioned, that, oh, I don't want to do it once a week. Maybe now I will not publish anything, but I will publish something next week. Then if we don't make this decision in the very beginning, then we can change our mind after some time. And listeners, I don't think that they like it, because and this effect of not having the audience in the beginning, it hit so hard. I remember that in the beginning, I was used to speaking to live public, as I'm a business trainer. I'm working with groups. I'm working with people. I'm a lecturer. I'm working with students. So I like seeing the faces. I'm used to it. And I, in the beginning, I did not get any feedback on my podcast. Just a couple of my friends, of course, wrote to me, but I did not hear anything for a couple of months. And then after some time, people started contacting me, maybe after half a year or almost a year. Now I'm getting those messages regularly. And oh, by the way, I'm listening to your podcast. It is amazing. Oh, I'm listening to every episode. And I'm like, oh, where have you been for a year? Yeah. It is, yeah. I think that this, it is so important to make this decision at the very beginning and to do this consistently. And what do you think, how can we get people to listen to us? Because from my experience, in the beginning, people listen because it is a launch, it is something new. Then we need to get this base of our listeners. We need some time, but there is this moment when we hit the bottom, and the launch excitement is gone, and we still don't have many listeners. So how to ensure from the very beginning that we have a lot of listeners?
Yeah, great question. So there's a couple of things that you want to think about on that. And that is, if we're thinking about really who our ideal client is and really where your expertise is, and obviously we're hoping that what you provide as far as the content, this is for everyone listening and watching, of course, the content that you provide very much speaks value and insights and, you know, solutions to what they're struggling with. So often I think as businesses, we tend to only provide surface stuff. So what you want to do is dive really deep. I always love going, what are three key themes that you want to become known for? And those themes really should tie together to be able to help your ideal clients achieve an outcome. And then have a look at some subtopics. What can you speak into those themes that is going to be of relevance to your ideal client? And this is along their customer journey. So in other words, what are they struggling with? How's that impacting them? And really speak into that. Now, you're going to have some clients, if you think about the solutions that you offer, that once they get some ahas from your podcast, they're going to think, well, my goodness, what else can I learn? So always make sure that the call to action at the end of your podcast is getting them off your podcast and onto your list so that you can continue to build know, like, and trust. That's one key thing, because doing that is going to mean that people who are just maybe new listeners, or maybe they've listened to a number of shows, they're now stepping even closer to you and part of your community, and they're listening because they like you. You know, you're developing that know, like, and trust, and they like you as a person. So they're going to subscribe and want to listen because they just love who you are, what you stand for. And obviously, you know, when you think about your ideal client, they may not necessarily be ready to make a decision yet to work with you, but they want to hang around with you. So that's really important. Make sure that you continue to build that know, like, and trust, not just with the podcast, but other ways as well. Some of us have created communities. You might have another platform such as LinkedIn or Instagram that you're very frequent on, and you're providing great content. So draw them to that attention so that you can start engaging with them there too. So you're kind of cross-popular, propagating, or whatever the word is. You know, they're both on those different platforms and really engaging with you. Secondly, remember that your podcast is also a platform that you can then interview other people. Now, don't do what I did, and that was interview anyone and everyone that was in business. My podcast, and I still have this one, that's my award-winning podcast, The Ambitious Entrepreneur Show. But I did not really do what I'm, you know, years ago, what I'm suggesting now, and that was be very clear on where it is that I want to position myself. So my message got lost in the noise of my own podcast. But similarly, I had anyone and everyone who could talk about business. Now, of course, I'm far more focused. I know who my ideal client is. There are a lot more service-based businesses, coaches, consultants who really are selling their expertise. That's what they're doing. And so the guests that I have on the show, I know either provide value in another area of expertise that my ideal client is struggling with, or secondly, they are a circle of influence already or have a circle of influence with my ideal clients. So they could be a really good alliance partner, or they've got quite a large community of my ideal clients. So interviewing them on my podcast is going to provide value. But as they continue to share my podcast episode where I'm interviewing them to their audience, it naturally builds awareness with a whole group of new people who could potentially be my ideal clients. And I do that, you know, quite strategically as I'm looking at various guests. I tend to, you know, some people love to interview high profile guests. Well, I would rather have people who are not necessarily high profile because they don't really need to share a lot because they're already high profile. And because they're already exposed across so many, you know, platforms already, they're pretty much already well known. So I would rather feature people who are really doing some incredible things in their industry. They're challenging the status quo. They're innovating, doing all of that, and is going to bring real benefit to my, you know, audience. And then through that, you know, the cross sharing to our audiences is going to benefit both of us. And so that's really a strategy that I've continued to do, you know, for quite some time. And it's just consistently building, you know, the audience. And be mindful that I think all of us can probably repurpose every single episode far more than we already are. Like if you're already sharing it across, you know, two or three different platforms, triple down on the content that you share. Create more graphics, create more audio snippets of the quotes or the, you know, the sentence or two that was shared that really speaks into what you know your ideal client is struggling with. Make that into an audio, you know, an audiogram, you know, craft and cut out video snippets, do some infographics, all of that, and continue to share and make sure it's getting out in front of your ideal client. You're using hashtags, you know, that captures that attention. And if you do that consistently, you will continue to build that audience. And make sure you share it across different platforms. I was just speaking to a client the other day. She's doing a lot of sharing of content on LinkedIn, and she got a paid speaking gig, I think a couple actually, off LinkedIn. I said, are you consistently sharing your podcast episodes? Oh no, I must do that a bit more, she said. So we're all kind of guilty of that. We should really be able to, you know, publish and repurpose content to consistently build that audience. Don't be afraid to share, you know, a number of times, because the good problem to have would be if everyone was listening or watching at the same time when you tweeted or you posted on Facebook or LinkedIn. You know, everyone around the world saw that, and it doesn't happen. So, you know, don't be scared to republish things as part of your content sharing.
Yeah, really, really great tips. I think that we need to speak about our podcasts more. Me, definitely, you inspired me to post on LinkedIn more of my podcast episodes, because we need to do so many things, and we need to edit and to post, to repurpose, create those snippets. And when you think about this, and when you see the professional podcasters who have teams who are doing all of this, it is a bit sad, you know, that we cannot do this, we cannot do it all. So what would you recommend to beginners who are just starting, who don't have the team of people who will write posts and create audios, create snippets, post here, there, YouTube, LinkedIn, Instagram? What is the most important thing, one or two, in communication in order to communicate your podcast properly?
Yeah. One of the things that I'm only just starting to create now, and I do have a team, obviously, that supports me. Although I must say, I'm probably, as all business leaders, we're our own worst bottleneck in our business, aren't we? So, but what I have created and why I, so stick with me, this is why it's going to be helpful for you. Because eventually, as you continue to grow your business, because I'm assuming, you know, all of your listeners are either having a podcast because they want to get a promotion or be well known within their organization and therefore get opportunities to, you know, put their hand up for more projects or maybe that role that they've been eyeing for a while, or they're wanting to grow business. And so eventually you can either hire someone within your team if a or maybe, you know, your corporation is going to support you and do some sponsorship dollars towards that, or you're going to hire someone. And so often what we do is we don't have a place where we have all of our content. So what I've created is some different folders. And so those folders and then a spreadsheet which has all the different snippets and all the different information, making it very easy to find, which means it can be repurposed. And I can go to that sheet. What have I written about that podcast already? And what have I shared? I even have the date on that, you know, when it was shared and what platforms, so that we can repurpose it, slightly tweak it across another platform, or particularly this is for Twitter, they don't like you sharing the same content, you know, word for word, so verbatim each time. So you can change it up a little bit and maybe create a different graphic, but particularly the words. And the reason I think that that's really handy is that once you start creating that, you can build on that and build all and add, actually add all of your social media kind of posts to that, not just your podcasts. And then, of course, is just consistently make a time in your diary. You know, how often for the time being are you going to spend half a day creating snippets and so forth? Have some of those publishing tools. I know that Canva, you know, Hootsuite, we use a Posto plan now. But if you use some of those automation tools, you can spend half a day, say, writing up content, scheduling that so that you don't have to be there for the coming week or weeks when you have posted that. So it really is a focused, and then you can get on it, you know, on your day and week. So I think use those particular tools and find the ones that work really well for you. And then eventually when you are at the, you know, at the stage where you can hire someone, you can then set up some training videos to train them on how to then take over those particular platforms for risk, you know, scheduling and posting and those sorts of things. So start off small, make it sure it's all created in the one area, easy to find. Like me, it's like, where did I file that document? But if it's all in one place, you got folders and a nice spreadsheet with different tabs and so forth, easier to find, and then a team can take over once you're ready to expand your team.
Yes, perfect. So we can start small. We don't have to do it all from the very beginning. Don't look at people who are running their podcasts for over 10 years, for 5 years, for even for 1 year, because now as I have my podcast for a year, I'm doing things completely differently than I did 1 year ago. I know where can I have a team to do some things, where do I need to plan myself, and I think that in the very beginning, it is very, very important to focus on the planning and strategizing in order to be more successful later on. And Anne-Marie, you mentioned that we can actually get leads and get clients out of the podcast. So what can you recommend to our listeners? What can we do during the podcast, before, after, or in our communication online, in order to get not only get listeners and subscribers, but also to get clients later on?
Yeah, that's such a great question. I stumbled across this particular tactic that I'll share with you in a moment. When I started Women in Leadership podcast, I started that podcast after a partnership kind of was terminated unexpectedly. And I now call it my worst business failure ever, which is, by the way, now the best thing that ever happened to me, because it led me down the path that I am now working in today. However, back then, I could not create content, and I could really see that I was quite burned out. Couldn't create content, and I am a prolific expert content creator, love writing courses and all those things. And I thought, I have to still continue doing something and I can ask really good questions. So I thought, I'm going to surround myself with other incredible women, business leaders, women leaders in corporate. So I started Women in Leadership Podcast. And an interesting thing happened. 3 episodes in on my website, so only 3 episodes, I generated 2 4-figure clients. They had no idea who I was. They Googled branding business consultant, came to the website, listened to the 3 episodes, had a look around the website, and then pretty much rang me and said, well, we love what you're doing. We want to work with you. What's the best program to be able to work with you? And it wasn't until a number of years later I thought, boy, if I could do that accidentally from a podcast that I created selfishly because I really needed it to get over my own, you know, healing and grief and loss. Imagine if I backtracked the steps that I needed to take that enabled these 2 women who knew me not at all and then decide we want to work with her. So I kind of, that's really what I teach now. But here's the strategy that I came up with, and that was to create a 3-part podcast series which is specifically focused on your ideal client, speaks to them about their most pressing challenge, and you should know what they are. That's why I say start with the end in mind. And so you lead them through that 3-part episode. It's kind of your gift. I call it your irresistible signature giveaway. Each episode is a standalone, but it seeds and leads into the next one. So you're taking them on a journey. So by the time they've listened to all of those 3 episodes, and I always say to my clients, create a bit of a checklist or a quiz that goes alongside that. You might have a workbook there, some other pieces of content. So it is really getting them into almost what I call a promise of value and promise of expectation. They've been coached by you. There's some mini wins. There's just enough information not to overwhelm, but rather to wow that ideal client where they've said, I've never even heard about these kind of things. This is really innovative. You know, all of those different things that you've packaged in that. And then at the end of those 3 episodes, the call to action is either, well, depending obviously on someone's business model, you know, a strategy session, or there may be a mini course or something like that. But you set that up so that at the end of the interview, or whether you're doing a solo show, you know that you're speaking to your ideal clients. So for instance, for me, I know that I'm speaking to people who would love to become known as the trusted authority in their industry, and they're ambitious. So I might say, and I do have an outro that says, now, if you're here because you feel like the world's best kept secret and you want to know how you can stand out, be heard, become that influential voice in your industry, sign up for our 3-part podcast series where I'll take you step by step through what you need to know and have in place. We give them a link. And then that's just a consistent call to action that, you know, people are invited to step into. And I use that call to action and my podcast series, even across social media. If I'm being interviewed on podcasts, I'll probably share it today, or I can do to give you an example of that. Or if I'm on TV or radio, you know, that kind of thing, it gets people off that platform and onto my list. And one of the reasons we do that, particularly for podcasts, for podcasting, is that many people listen to podcasts because they love that medium to engage and consume content. So often from a podcast, if you say, sign up for my video series or get download my ebook, a lot of people are thinking, well, I don't have time to read. Some people don't like reading, or I don't have time to watch long videos. But because they're listening already to the podcast, they've heard your voice, then they're most likely to then go, oh, I can listen to that. And of course, you might have a transcript or something like that. But, you know, give someone a medium of consumption on how they're consuming that content. So if you're doing something via video, give them something that has more of a visual aspect. So that's why the podcast series works so well. And whenever someone is launching the podcast, we always start with that 3 podcast series. So that's the first call to action. And that's why I say you can start nurturing listeners into leads from your very first episode. Now, it doesn't mean if you haven't created that to begin with that you've kind of missed that opportunity. You can create a special series and then use that in and of itself as another relaunch to your existing audience of something that's coming up. And then that continuously be that call to action. Does that make sense? Because it really is. You know, connecting and providing even more value to your ideal client and getting them off the podcast and onto your list. And that's where you continue to nurture that relationship.
Yeah, this is amazing, actually, because I never thought about this to lead people from one podcast to another podcast, because they actually love listening to the content. And I think it is an amazing idea.
And it's not a new podcast altogether. Yeah. It's just a series. It's a special series that's very much related to your existing podcast, but it's providing even more information that you know your ideal client will be struggling with, and it gets them into, you know, onto your list, because for them to be able to get access to all of the goodies that you've put together for them, they need to give their email and address, email address and name.
Yes, yeah, this call to action in the end is really important. What should people do after listening to our podcast? Where should they go? And I think that we can use this in our outro, in our intro of our podcast, to actually promote our services, to promote ourselves a little bit. Of course, we are creating content, but this is also a space to promote our services and to get those leads, to get new clients. Yeah. So Anne-Marie, let's sum up our conversation. So what should we do if we want to start a podcast, and if we want to make it profitable? What are the most important things to sum up everything we were speaking about?
So let's take this full circle and really sum it up. So firstly, you really need to think of the end in mind. How are you going to leverage your podcast? For some of you, your message needs to really be refined, because if you launch your podcast with your existing message, it's just not going to cut through the noise. You also need to know about how you're going to monetize it. And I know many of your listeners are service-based businesses, and so your message and your programs are really what you're going to monetize. And so have your call to action and where you're leading people to very much focused on where your expertise is, how you can help people, because you're speaking to your ideal client, who you're building that audience of trusted people who you know are going to benefit from you sharing your message, or the guests. So you need to be mindful about that. I think start off with the end in mind, as well as integrating your podcast with the other things that you are doing. So making sure that you are using other platforms to be able to cross promote, and then the other platforms promoting your podcast, so you're consistently getting exposure across those platforms. Get your system set up. If you get your system set up to promote your ongoing podcast and your publication dates, you know, so that you've got things planned in advance, you're probably going to be more likely to continue that momentum than if all of a sudden you run out of steam and all of a sudden you think, I haven't got a show prepared, I'll just let this week go. So set the systems up to support you, and so consistently really set that time in your diary to get that content created and then obviously published and promoted, but set it up with the end in mind, and that'll hold you in good stead.
Thank you. Thank you, Anne-Marie, so much for sharing so much value with us today on how to run our podcasts, how to make them profitable. If our listeners want to know more, want to work with you, want to contact you, where can they find you?
Sure, thank you. So I have a once a month a masterclass, Profitable and Purposeful Podcasting. And so I dive deeper into a lot of different things that I spoke about today. So podcastingwithpurpose.com/masterclass. And then if people, and I'll give the outro, which I share on my podcast. So if people want to know how they can, as a coach or a consultant, stand out, be heard, and become that trusted authority, that influential voice, my series, podcast series, you can download at theinfluencealliance.com/podcast series. So it's theinfluencealliance.com/podcast series.
Perfect. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Anne-Marie, for being here on Ideas and Leaders, for sharing so much value. It was a pleasure talking to you today.
And a pleasure. Thank you so much, Elena, for the opportunity.
Thank you for listening to Ideas and Leaders podcast. Did you enjoy this episode? Let me know that you listened by tagging me in your LinkedIn profile and using a hashtag Ideas and Leaders. See you in the next episode.